Good morning.
Morning.
I want to welcome everybody. Glad you're here. So after our meeting last week, we found out that Julian Bond passed away. Now, I was, in my prior life, I was the legal aide to the minority leader in the House, Georgia House of Representatives, two sessions. Now, you might think that the minority leader is like the president of the NAACP, but that's not really what the minority is. And back then, it was the Republicans. And I was the legal aide to the Republican leader. And his name, the first year I was doing that, was Carr Dotson, who was a lawyer from Macon. And seated behind Carr Dotson and over one seat was Julian Bond. And back then, they didn't care where people like me would sit, so I would go over and sit in Carr Dotson's seat all the time. And I got to know Julian Bond pretty well. It was interesting because he'd been there for a little while, but he never really participated much. He didn't do much while he was there, and he later went on to the Senate. About a year or two later, I was at the Atlanta airport, back when you could go to the gates, and I went to the gate to meet, anybody remember that? I went to the gate to meet some cousins of mine who were coming for the weekend, and there was Julian Bond, the first one off the plane. So I went over to him and said, "Hello, Mr. Bond, welcome to Atlanta. How long do you expect to be here?" And I went like that, and he kind of looked at me like, "Give me a break." I want to say one other thing about Julian Bond. This is, of course, you know, the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act and things like that. And I get a magazine called Moment Magazine. And in there, they were interviewing a number of people concerning what happened 50 years ago. And Julian Bond said, well, he had gotten, they had this Sanders v. Gray case where they did with one man, one vote, and they went ahead and they did reapportionment, and he ran. He decided, although he was in his early 20s, that he was going to run for state representative, and he ran for state representative, got elected. Ooh. And when they went to put him in there, when they went to see everybody, they said no, they didn't like his views on Vietnam and stuff, and so they refused to seat him, and they declared it vacant. So they had a new election. He ran again, and he won, and he went over there to get sworn in, and again he was rejected because they declared it vacant. So he ran a third time and got elected. This time he filed a lawsuit in federal court, and they ended up having a three-judge federal group, and according to Bond, and it was one of Carter's appointees who turned him down, until ultimately the Supreme Court of the United States approved him, allowed him to go be seated. And I thought, couldn't possibly be Jimmy Carter's appointees. This was in the 60s. Carter wasn't even governor. This was federal. So I went and looked it up, and it was Griffin Bell who was on that group. He had been appointed by Kennedy. So anyway, I want to welcome everybody. We have a number of people here that we'd like to hear from. We have my city councilman, Jim Reitheiser, and we have my judge. Everybody ought to have a judge. I always thought you need to watch out for people who are judges who won't tell you their first name and they use initials. I said that to C.J. Becker, and look what happened to her.
Yeah, right.
But at any rate, when she resigned or retired, the governor's commission made some recommendations, and J.P. Boulee has been appointed as a Superior Court judge as of what, July 1st, something like that. So we're glad you're here. And but if you really want to go back into history, I want to bring up Ann Lewis's partner, Frank Strickland. Frank and I have known each other since, back in the... back in the young Republican days. I'm just introducing you. You can have a seat back down there. Frank, you can pick where you're sitting, and look where you're sitting. Seriously, Frank Strickland has been one of the mainstays of the state Republican Party and Fulton County Republican Party for all these years. So I'm glad that my senator, who is in the Atlanta newspaper today, my senator, Fran, Millar is sitting there with him, so I want to welcome you, Frank, and glad you're here. Our moderator, Bob Dallas.
Wow, thank you.
Thank you.
all for being here. Of course, it's my pleasure to be here with each of you. Well, obviously, we have some great guests we're going to hear from today. Now, just realize when we have judges that come, we give them the courtesy of being first up, always, because some of our topics may get a little bit too testy for them to continue staying here. But secondly, they can be somewhat, they have to be somewhat circumscribed as to what they say, not talking about current cases or current events that influence their office. So questions about that will be off bounds. That's part of my job to make that boundary for our guests. And we always appreciate the fact that judges come here because, as we know, they're such an important part of DeKalb County. Speaking of that, I think it's on Tuesday at 5 to 7 at the 57th Aero Squadron. Judge Mike Jacobs will be having a fundraiser. So for those of you who want to see Judge Mike Jacobs come on back, as they say, you might want to consider attending that. We are supporting that from the Tysinger Breakfast, given that he's spoken here and has been a longtime representative of DeKalb County.
Not today.
No, it's Tuesday.
Tuesday.
No, not today.
What time?
5 to 7 p.m. And so you know, it's open. If you just want to stop by, I'm sure he'd love to have you there, even if you want, don't want to pony up the campaign cash that runs these machines to get reelected. Well, obviously, it's been a busy week with DeKalb County, and we've seen things come out in the paper the past couple days. And because Judge Boulee's here, I'm not going to get into that, but maybe next week. Now, I was hoping to see Catherine Bernard here because she's been in a, talking a bit about the election that what's the new guy that won in District 80?
Taylor Bennett.
And so I wanted her to be here today. We didn't have time last week. She wants to speak then, but we had other speakers, and so just keep that in mind if you see her. Of course, we have our sheriff, Jeff Mann.
Good morning.
And as Tammy says, sit down.
He's rounding up election officials.
Right. Well, I let me just say this. I mean, we've had some convictions. We've had some sentences handed down this past week that we are familiar with, I'm sure, if you read the paper. So all I know is I got it covered. I got the judge that'll sentence me and the guy that'll take care of me. So hopefully that'll be okay. So in that respect, not too much for me. There are some exciting things on the world stage. I do have to make this one comment. You probably saw, like I did, in Syria, the town of Palmyra, is that, that's how you pronounce it correctly, one of the oldest archaeological Roman ruins in the world. You know, you see pictures, I'm impressed and think, man, what a great place that would be to go. Of course, with ISIS coming in, you always run the risk that that stuff will be torn down. But how barbaric is it that they would execute the fellow who was born there, lived there, studied there, shared that without throughout the world, that they would execute that fellow? I mean, he was in his mid-80s. I mean, you got to step back and think, well, what justification on earth is there for that, for somebody that's giving out information? Well, now you know the answer. Yeah. The people who are willing to disclose and share information are the enemy. I don't know about you, but, you know, we can only hope that this nation and all other nations are clear in our purpose in eliminating that from this earth based on these kinds of things. And it's just horrific. And, you know, I dare say that similarly, the head of that organization was actually involved with raping the American missionary who was killed. I mean, you read that and you go, you know, what justification is there for this organization and their people? I don't have any, and I think that, like all of you, I'm sure, that should be gone. All right, well, now more interesting things with that note. Jay, can you come on up? And, you know, it's interesting because now we have a lot of new judges in DeKalb County. We know that. And thank you for being here. And, you know, one of the best questions I want to know is, so you go in with certain expectations.
Right.
You've been there for a little bit. What's the difference from what you expected versus now what you see? Because you were an outsider, an attorney before the bar, the bench. And now you are the bench.
That's right.
So here we go, your crowd. Thank
great,
you.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Bob. Appreciate y'all having me. And thanks for everyone for being here. I gave the long version of my bio last time I was here when Ann Lewis was kind enough to come introduce me to your group. So I won't go into much detail about my background. But suffice it to say, grew up in DeKalb County, attended DeKalb County Public Schools. I'm a proud graduate of DeKalb County Public Schools. Went to college on an Army ROTC scholarship and then came back to the University of Georgia for law school. paid back my commitment to the Army by serving for 4 years on active duty with the 101st Airborne Division, both as a prosecutor and as a pro bono public defender, and then came out and worked for the international law firm Jones Day and worked underneath Richard Dean for 14 years before happily being appointed to the bench by Governor Deal. Been there about a month and a half now, and I absolutely love the job and I love DeKalb County. I think I'm gonna be able to do some good things on the bench. The most important priority I have this first year, or the end of this term, is to establish the Veterans Court. And I think I mentioned that to a few of you before, but want to let everybody know I've made a lot of headway on that. As Bob mentioned, came from private practice into the government, and there are sometimes a few more hoops to jump through in the government than other things, which I'm quickly learning. So I've got a laundry list of things to do as to Veterans Court, but we are working down the list. I'm happy to report that everyone I've talked to so far, whether it is state representatives, senators, county commissioners, other people in authority in DeKalb County are fully supportive of this, and I've got a working group together, and I think we're rolling forward towards establishing that Veterans Court. So I'm really excited about that. To circle back and answer Bob's question, what's been different, private practice versus working in the government? I will say, at Jones Day, I had about 5, maybe 10 cases at any given time, and there was a little bit of a vacancy when I got to Division 6 of DeKalb County Superior Court, so some cases had piled up, and I had 1,200 cases when I first got there, so that gives you a little bit of a perspective what it's like to be a Superior Court judge. But you know, absolutely love it over there. I think things are going really well. Wanted to make one quick point. Bob was kind enough to let me come up here first. As he said, judges go first. I guess it gets controversial. But that, as I was sitting there and he said that, I thought to myself, well, I want to make sure everybody in this audience knows what I feel about the judiciary's role. You know, we have three branches of government: executive, legislative, and judiciary. And I believe very firmly that it's a judge's role to apply the law, not make the law. I see Senator Millar back there. It's his branch's job to decide what the law is going to be, and it's my job to make sure once litigants come to court to apply the law fairly. So I want to make sure you know where I stand on that, and I think that's where every judge should stand. Having said that, be happy to take a couple questions, but then I want to turn it over to some of the other speakers. I really just wanted to come and say a quick hello. So if we've got one or two questions, happy to answer them if anybody has them. Yes, sir.
Can you comment on the Judicial Qualifications Commission work with C.J. Becker? What was their problem with her?
Well, that'd be an inappropriate question right now, I think, given his role and what they're doing. Because I don't think it's fair to put the judge in a position of having to address that. So I'm going to have to create a boundary for you on that one, if that's okay.
Well, let me reword it. I'm really wondering, what is the job of the JQC?
If you want to, but in general, the JQC is to ensure that the judges live up to their canons of ethics. The judges have a separate canons of ethics that is promulgated by the state Supreme Court, and in there are very specific things that they are to do. And in that regard, the JQC will take complaints from anybody and look at the complaints, determine whether or not investigations are appropriate, if they are, do the investigation, and then work accordingly. Now, I will say that typically the JQC, which then reports to the Supreme Court that can remove a judge through that recommendation, that in the case of CJ, a little thing different has occurred. There you had a Cobb County event, and rather than a Cobb DA get involved, another DA was brought in, and based on those circumstances, a decision was made, as we've read the paper, to indict CJ on several felonies and one misdemeanor associated with what she said. That's just in the paper. It'd be unfair for the judge not to have to address any of that.
I guess my point would be the casual observer would wonder about objectivity, but that's always a problem.
It can be. Let me say thank you.
Yeah, okay, thank you so much. I'll be around for a little while.
I served as attorney for a number of years, and being an attorney for any organization, whether it's the Democratic Party or the Republican Party, is probably never an easy thing. you know, we're bad cats when it comes to kind of being heard at all. So first I will say thank you. I know Ann does it now, but you've done great work for us. All right, there she is, Captain.
Sorry, I was thinking they could turn the music down, but he says it's as low as it goes right now.
It is. It's one of those unfortunate things. It comes with the territory here. But come on, Catherine. Last week I'd asked Catherine to speak, and unfortunately we ran out of time. So with that, I was going to bring you on up and give the floor to you, take you know, like 10 or 15 minutes to talk about things. Obviously, House System Katie, you were involved with, and the outcome is a surprise to some, not a surprise to others. And you've obviously remained engaged, and as I understand things, have indicated your intent to knock on that door again. Is that right?
Nothing necessarily official, but we're certainly looking at the best way to get House District.
All right, so I'll give you Catherine Bedard.
Thank you so much, Bob.
You're welcome. Move up a little bit up here just so that they can hear you back there. And go Jeff, as they say.
Come on this way, Catherine, so we can hear you.
Well, yes.
And don't let him throw anything at you.
Okay. I'll try not to. Anybody bring vegetables or anything like that? All right, everybody, so thank you for the introduction, Bob. I'm Catherine Bernard. I actually came and spoke to y'all earlier this spring before the House District 80 race had officially started, when we had just heard the word that Mike Jacobs was going to be appointed to a judgeship and we would have an open seat in House District 80. And that indeed happened. The governor called a special election the day after House leadership elections on May 12th, and I did announce the same day for House District 80. Actually, a few days later, the mayor of Brookhaven then announced, but he didn't step down as mayor. He just announced that he was planning to run and that he would step down during qualifying, which left us in a kind of an interesting situation for a couple of weeks in Brookhaven, where we had a sitting mayor campaigning for state representative even from the dais at a city council meeting. So that was an interesting perspective. So we had a couple of weeks there where things were a little up in the air. But after qualifying, it turned out there were three Republicans and one Democrat in the race. And you know, this was not a primary. Some people have been referring to the special election as a primary, but the July 14th election was a special election. So there was not necessarily going to be a runoff, but with four people in the race, it was pretty likely. So we did end up with three Republicans in the race. Myself, J. Max Davis, the former mayor of Brookhaven, and then a gentleman named Lauren Collins, who actually an interesting fellow, really went to law school right after Mike Jacobs, had followed his career, and that was what motivated him to run. He knew Mike Jacobs and heard about the open seat. So we had three Republicans in the race, had an interesting campaign, lots of mailers, the usual, and I did end up coming up short by 56 votes. We had a real heartbreaker for the campaign. So Taylor Bennett, the Democrat, came in with, I believe, 1472, which surprised a lot of folks. They didn't realize the Democrats had been making such an active play for House District 80. But one thing I want people to remember is that because Mike Jacobs had been elected as a Democrat and then switched over to a Republican and was very well liked in the district, that was kind of masking a bit of a purple shift that was happening in House District 80 that some of us noticed in Brookhaven, particularly the southern parts of Brookhaven, you know, districts 2, 3, and 4 that are, you know, historic Brookhaven, south of Peachtree, the more urban, younger areas versus the parts up towards Dunwoody in the north. So a lot of us were aware of this trend, you know, that the Democrats were making a play in House District 80, and they really put a lot of resources in from the House caucus level. Their candidate, Taylor Bennett, didn't have any experience in the community, and that was in fact why some of the Democrats were reluctant to support him, because of his lack of experience. They thought that, you know, that it would be better to have somebody who had a record of, you know, ethics reform in Brookhaven. But he did end up, you know, sitting out a lot of paid canvassers, getting a lot of votes, and came in first. Then we had that 56 vote split between myself and J. Max Davis. And now, you know, J. Max and I have known each other for a couple of years now. You know, I started going to city council meetings as soon as my husband and I moved to Brookhaven. And we've been involved in a couple of different legislative issues. You know, there was an opportunity zone tax credit that he was seeking to get for our city. You know, I read through it and I had some concern. You know, it says opportunity zone tax credit, but really you end up having to pay a lobbying firm about $120,000 to get the federal government to declare your area as blighted. So just because you're going to end up with a $3,500 tax credit, it's a little bit, you know, nerve-wracking to think about getting that kind of federal government involvement at the city level. And I think that's what a lot of us have worried about with the addition of city government. So I'd also interacted with him on some, the mayor, on some litigation that Brookhaven has been involved in. I've been consistently concerned that Brookhaven has been spending too much on lawyers, and I am a lawyer, so I can recognize when you've got a lot of folks working on things. So there have definitely been some issues throughout the tenure of his mayorship that we had differed on. The main one being the redevelopment powers law, which he, along with Mike Jacobs, had tried to get on the ballot in Brookhaven, and that's something that would have expanded debt and eminent domain powers, so a real problem from a small government perspective. I chaired the committee to defeat that redevelopment powers law, which was actually very successful. We were proud of that, and that's one of the things that we had tried to build on during the campaign, was people who wanted transparency, people who wanted accountability. And we built a pretty cool bipartisan coalition, you know, with the eye too beating a Democrat, you know, because we don't want to have the Democrats come in and say, you know, oh, you've got your ethics reform, but, you know, we'll be raising your taxes and increasing the regulations on your businesses along the way. You know, that's not the kind of ethics reform that anybody wants. So I've been really trying to push a conservative vision of ethics reform, where we look at how we can reduce the tax burden on individuals, where we look at how we can reduce government involvement in people's lives. And I think that's a vision that, you know, we're getting some traction on in Brookhaven. However, we did have a lot of support from leadership, you know, for my opponent, that he did get a lot more donations than I did from folks in the House and Senate. And, you know, I'm not going to say that was a factor. There's certainly other things. I had, you know, two big trials going on during that special election period. So there's all sorts of factors. You can't blame any one thing. But we did end up with J-Max in the runoff. It was a tough runoff. You know, some of the issues that had been coming up before that I actually kind of alluded to the first time I spoke to y'all, that we had some scandals in the AJC. You know, I didn't run on that. I didn't run a negative campaign. I didn't go around trying to bash anyone, because that just, you know, tears at the fabric of our community in Brookhaven. J-Max was from Brookhaven. You know, his family was from Brookhaven. You know, there's no need to tear somebody down. You want to just offer something more positive. But things did get pretty ugly between him and the Democrat, and I think that was a big factor in a very substantial loss. You know, it was a 500 vote difference, so it was not even close. And this is a district that has been specifically designed to be Republican leaning, with the removal of the Toco Hills area and the addition of Sandy Springs. You know, it went for Romney about 54%, so it was, we were looking for it to be a Republican district, but a 29-year-old Democrat won by a substantial margin. So I, you know, I'm looking at this as, you know, this is a disappointment for me, because I am now being represented by someone whose chief claim to fame is being a quarterback for Georgia Tech, which my husband did go to Georgia Tech, so, you know, there are worse qualifications, certainly. But I'm really nervous about what he has expressed as his vision of big government. You know, he's part of the millennial generation, and, you know, I'm actually the oldest millennial at 33, apparently, but he is 29, and his motivation to get into this race was RFRA. He said that when he heard about RFRA, he said that if it passed, that his gay mother would not be able to go to Starbucks because they would want to not let gay people in. And now I am a passionate advocate of equal rights for all, and in fact, my aunt is also gay, and I would never condone any discrimination against anyone. But for him to make that claim that RFRA was going to cause Starbucks to not let gay people in, that to me just bespeaks a very deep misunderstanding of the way that regulations affect our lives and the way that RFRA was intended. You know, I didn't like the way it was written, and, you know, Josh McCoon is actually coming to speak to the DeKalb Young Republicans in September on this. I think the language could be cleaned up. But I think this is a real example of how progressives, even though they are often preaching enlightenment and tolerance, they are looking to do it by forcing more government regulations on people. And I just, you know, I know most of the folks in this room are already on the same page, but that's a real worry that we have, you know, interacting with these independents and Democrats in Brookhaven, that, you know, they're wonderful people, so well motivated, you know, they want equal rights for all, but they're looking to the state to get it. And that's a really dangerous situation, and that's why I think Taylor Bennett is so dangerous. He talks a great game on ethics reform, accountability, but he doesn't have the experience to see the actual places where your ethics get challenged, and he has a vision of a very expansive state role. So I think we've got to get rid of him. You know, fortunately this is only a one legislative session term. He'll be up for election in November 2016. You know, hopefully this will be a session where they can't do much damage in terms of raising taxes and otherwise increasing the role of government. And hey, who knows? We've had a Democrat switch to Republican before in this district, so anything's possible. I'm just looking for how we can turn this back to some conservative control. But the thought that I would like to leave folks with is that this is a real example of how conservative thoughts and principles have to evolve in the 21st century in order to, I don't want to say stay relevant, because they'll always be relevant, but in order to retain and continue appealing to new people. We can't be a party, we can't be a conservative movement of people who don't seem open to new ideas, who don't seem open to new people, who don't seem welcoming. We want to be welcoming to everyone, just, you know, recognizing that we would like to welcome you to, you know, not take all of our money and control our lives through a government that ends up, you know, being pretty corrupt on a lot of levels, as we see in DeKalb. And that actually provides a really great opportunity for us, you know, being in DeKalb, because even the Democrats see, you know, this is just ridiculous what we're looking at. You know, we are looking at corruption that, you know, has become almost a punchline. You know, it's like, what's the newest line? We even get, you know, great folks like Nancy Jester elected to the commission, and, you know, we still see things like Lee May actually filming an announcement video for that stadium deal 2 days before the county commission vote. He filmed a video, like a professionally shot video, announcing, we have this wonderful new stadium deal. That was before the vote was taken. That, to me, is a dangerous sign for the health of our fundamental republic. And so I see House District 80 as a great place to really take that back, to show that conservatives have the ethics reform, have the economic opportunity, have really the principles and values that will cause us all to be happier, healthier, and more prosperous. So that's the message that I'm going to be taking forward, and it does look like I probably will be running for House District 80 again. And this time, you know, I've learned a lot. I used to be a little bit shy about reaching out and asking for money because I thought, oh, you know, politics, it's, you know, it's almost a little embarrassing because you see so much corruption when you talk to your friends about it. But this has really energized a lot of people, seeing what happened, seeing that we've got a session with someone who explicitly believes in big government. So we've got a lot of work to do. I'm ready to start on that work. We're continuing with this coalition, and I really appreciate, you know, getting the chance to be here and be a part of this forum. So happy to answer any questions, either now or afterwards.
Let me just, I'll start. One of the questions that came up during the runoff was, why are you not engaged in supporting Republican nominee, being that you're one of the Republicans in the election? So, and yeah, I think you've answered it, but I don't know that everybody has heard your answer, so today may be a good chance to articulate that.
Absolutely. You know, I did not endorse JMAX, and he did ask for my endorsement. I want to emphasize, you know, he actually did come to my victory party, and, you know, we went to lunch with him and his campaign manager. You know, he did reach out, and I do appreciate his efforts. And I do think that, you know, he's looking to be a good conservative like his dad. But ultimately, I was too concerned with the record that he had built up in Brookhaven. And again, I'm not talking about things that, you know, other people had told me. I'm talking about direct conversations and interactions, you know, at the government level. I was very concerned that his perception of his philosophy of government allowed for a lot of control, even though it was called free market. And the Opportunity Zone tax credit that I just mentioned is kind of an example of that. You know, JMAX was a big supporter of that. And the fact that we couldn't get on the same page about recognizing how problematic it was for the federal government to come in and declare, you know, the area around the MARTA station, which includes my house, as blighted, the fact that he couldn't understand the danger of it really made me think that we need to work on that understanding of being conservative. I'll also tell you, quite frankly, this outcome was not a surprise to me or anyone else who was knocking on doors. The scandals that were associated with Brookhaven, you know, the Lysol spraying was unfortunately only the tip of the iceberg. There was a cronyism investigation where a contract was improperly given to his father-in-law. There were contracts improperly given to people on the planning commission. There were multiple allegations of behavior that can be described as retaliation. And, you know, these are not things that I am happy to have to say. And that, you know, people have told me that I should have talked about it more during the special election. And maybe I should have, because I think a lot of the people, you know, a lot of the people who voted for him would not have done so if they understood how weak he was against this Democrat. But I knew that he had so damaged his reputation in Brookhaven that I was not going to be able to save him. I was only going to be able to further drag down the work that we had done as conservatives and Republicans in the district. So it was a hard decision. I didn't announce it till the day before the election. But I know that it was not me that caused the loss, because we had the governor and the secretary of state. We had elected officials knocking on doors. There was a lot of Republican push, but the answer from House District 80 was, you know, if this is a Republican, then it's not what we're looking for. And that's the unfortunate situation we're in. So thank you for the opportunity.
Any other questions? All right, thank you, Kevin.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. Did you read your paper today?
Oh, Sheriff Joe.
Sheriff. Okay, come on up.
Sheriff Joe.
We don't want to take him off.
No, we don't. Thank you for being here. Let me just take a second. I had the opportunity to go to your event last week. It was a great event down at the Port of Sanford Performing Arts Center. Had a large crowd of folks there. And I just want to say, you know, as a citizen of DeKalb County, thank you for what you do in operating the jail, the courthouse services, and warrants. And as a highway safety guy, because you know I'm that, right? More than anything else.
Oh yeah.
Within the past few weeks, you actually had some road checks that you were doing in Lithonia area that were designed to make our roads safer and to make our communities safer. And I thought, how great is that? And that you got press for it means that everybody knows. So watch out, drive safe, buckle up, don't drive drunk, and slow down. And if you do that, then we're all good to go. Otherwise, I just want to say thank you for another great show.
Appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I was not on the speaker's list, so I will be brief. Again, as Bob said, it's campaign election time. Season's coming up. I had my kickoff a week ago last Thursday. And again, I got a lot of good reception. And I was pleased to hear the rumor that everyone here will be pulling a Democratic ballot in the primary. just so you can vote for me. So I was pleased to hear that. That warms my heart. So thank you so much. And but no, we're just moving along. We're operating the sheriff's office. We're working hard. We're doing the good work. As I said before many times, law enforcement, sheriff's office. I don't know why it's partisan, because it's not a partisan job in my opinion. Law enforcement, no political affiliation, but that's the way it is, so we have to pick a party. And I want to assure you that I'm here to represent all of DeKalb, regardless of political affiliation, regardless of north, south, east, and west. And I want to assure you that we're working for the best interests of all of DeKalb County citizens, and we're just trying to do a good job. So I appreciate your continued support. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. It's good to be back here.
Yeah, Sheriff, I wanted to know, is DeKalb County operating as a sanctuary county?
No, the answer is no.
What was the question, Sheriff?
The question was, is DeKalb County operating as a sanctuary county? I think you all are familiar with that term, sanctuary. That's sanctuary for illegal immigrants. And the answer is no. As you may be aware, ICE is transitioning from a mandatory notification to a voluntary request for notification if there's someone in our custody that requires that it is suspected of being an illegal alien. And so we are going to cooperate with ICE with respect to that voluntary request. And in fact, we have ICE agents on site that go through the daily intake to find illegal aliens, to find who they believe are illegal aliens, and go through that process. But that's their process. We're not involved in that. But I do allow them to be on site to go through the roster to to determine whether or not there are any individuals that are
good.
Thank you. One comment of interest for those who've been around. When the Republican Party was the minority party, as I recollect clearly, now tell me if I'm wrong, Frank, did we not seek to have the prosecutor, solicitor, and sheriff's office become nonpartisan? That was part of the statewide platform.
Yeah.
So I don't know what became of that, but it's no longer there. But having said that, law enforcement is nonpartisan, and I appreciate what you do, and thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Something that we've heard about before, and the nuances of this I think are really interesting, because it does put in your hands a little bit more control of your property tax as it really relates to the valuation. So I'm sure you'll talk about that, and you got a better picture.
High school picture.
It's a high school picture. It looks good.
We also tried to get the CEO position.
Move down that way where people can hear you.
Partisan at the cap. Okay, trying to get the CEO position nonpartisan in DeKalb. And we passed it out of the Senate, but we can't pass it out of the House. I think a lot of my brethren over there in the House, they're concerned about making any races nonpartisan. So if the state turns, then of course they're afraid that the Democrats will be in control again or something. But it's a shame because we don't get to vote for the CEO, we don't get to vote for the sheriff. And to me, that's sort of sad, because those particular positions are defined, if you will, as nonpartisan for most of us. Bob alluded to the article in the paper that the AJC, it's in the opinion page, and I'm going to cover a couple of points here because I think they're very important for you. I worked with a gentleman named Walter Hotz for over 2 years on trying to reform the property tax appeal process. Who's ever gone down to appeal the property taxes? Okay. Probably not one of your more pleasant experiences when you go down there. And this particular law, it's HB 202, because remember, when you talk about taxes, they have to start in the House. So what we've done on some of these bills, we did this with the Unemployment Trust Fund, we did it in the Senate, passed it over to the House. This particular one, we made all the changes in the Senate to their particular bill. The original bill that came through, I think, was being written primarily by the tax assessor's offices. What a surprise, right? And so we went through several years of hearings. I can remember one particular one. Mike Jacobs chaired it, a subcommittee meeting, and I'm there with Walter, and every major county in the metro area was represented by their tax assessor to speak against some of these changes we wanted to make. This bill became effective July 1. There's certain features that aren't effective until January 1. And it's on, there's a summary of the article. They put out the part, I mentioned Nancy Jester's name in here, that she got it, because I introduced her to Walter, and she had him appear too at the town hall. They took her name out of the particular article. Otherwise, they actually wrote it the way I wrote it. But I'm gonna read you some of the provisions in the bill, because I think they're important. As of January 1st of the upcoming year, 2016, the taxpayer can request certain information on how the Board of Tax Assessors arrived at the new assessment values. And if they don't give it to you or respond in less than 10 days, then there are penalties. The tax assessor must now meet with you at your request within 30 days of your request. And again, if they don't do it, there's monetary penalties. Also, when you go in to talk to the assessor, you can record the interview like she's doing right here. That's a big thing. There was a court that said, well, you have the right to do it, doesn't mean they have to do it. So this specifically says they have to do it. You can put your opinion, and Walter recommends this, of the assessed value when you appeal. You put in a number. The reason you do that, if they don't do certain things, that becomes your value. So if you've got an idea what you think the value should be, you should put it on your appeal. If you have an appraisal done, and it was done 9 months prior to the date of the assessment, then the tax assessor has 45 days to say why or why not he's not going to use that value. And if you have more than one property, if you're a land baron like Paul Jennings here, then you can put this all into one appeal, so that saves you some money from attorneys. Catherine, Bob, I'm sorry about that.
Wait a second.
Frank, I wouldn't have brought that up if I forgot you were here today. I apologize for that. Probably the most significant thing that we did in this bill is the taxpayer can request that the county provide the evidence that the county will use against the taxpayer in the hearing. And you got to get it 7 days in advance. So you get to see what their case is, for lack of a better saying, before you walk in there. And that's probably the biggest thing. There's some negatives in this bill, which didn't come from us. Again, like most legislation, you don't get everything you want. I think Walter, the example he used, we went forward five steps and back two with this particular bill. It requires you, if you're going to appeal, you either have to attend the hearing or submit evidence in writing in order to get your property tax freeze. The freeze, you remember, if you get it, you get it for that year plus two more years. Now, also, if you file an appeal during while your values are frozen, you lose the freeze. I really don't like that. And finally, if the county made some errors like the description or characterization of the property during the freeze, then it lifts the freeze, if they made a mistake, in other words. Here's three things we need to do going forward, and I'd like to try to do this in the upcoming year in legislation. By state law, the tax assessor can't change an assessment once it's published. Once it's published, that's it. One county, you can guess who. I was trying to make this applicable for all states, and it's in the AJC, so I didn't name the county, but you all can figure out who it is. Is telling the Board of Equalization, that's Larry, Curly, and Moe, the three people you appear in front of, that they have the power to raise the taxpayer's assessment if evidence is presented in the appeal hearing that justifies the increase. Remember, the assessor can't, and they're telling people, yes, the assessor can. The Board of Equalization can do it. This needs to be prohibited by statute. Another county, guess who, is threatening to put in a letter that if they pursue an appeal, then the Board of Equalization may increase the assessment without limitation. Furthermore, the taxpayer will be given a space on the notice to sign and return if they wish to withdraw their appeal. In other words, if they did something like this, they would kill the appeal.
They're already doing it.
Well, I didn't want to go that far because that's sort of up in the air, but you think they're doing it already?
I'll receive.
All right, you got the letter. Okay. And finally, and here's the question that needs some deliberation and thought. And there's maybe some constitutional issues here because you're talking about market value. But there's something wrong when I get a letter like this from a gentleman in my district who read this column earlier when it was in another periodical that happened to be located in Dunwoody. Here's a guy's value went from 373 to 293, and the next year the county raised it to 452,000 in 1 year. Oh. Now folks, there's something wrong with this process when that's happened. And so the final provision is we need to look at a cap of how much an assessment could go up in a given year. And I don't know what the right answer there is. It's 10%, 5%, whatever the number happens to be. And so that needs some further discussion and such. But there's something very, very wrong when that can happen to somebody. Nobody's property changes in a year like that. We all know that. So, you know, people wonder what we do down there, okay, besides get our per diem and our big $17,000 salary. So, Kathy, you probably won by losing, just for the record, okay? But my point is this, okay? This took 2 years. This took 2 years fighting certain areas to get some of these things done. And remember, we went five steps forward and we went two steps back. Okay? That's what this process is all about. No, we didn't get everything we wanted. But I'll tell you what, you're a heck of a lot better off than you were, okay, going into this game. Because that field wasn't tilted. It was like this when you went down there on that process. So anyway, there's now someone said, well, why don't you just do away with the whole thing? Well, I also got 180 representatives and I got 55 other senators, and I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. Okay, it's sort of like, you know, right now we're trying to look at an independent school system, okay, which I think is a good idea. I think competition's good. This past week, it looks like Brookhaven, that they're going to be able to have a state charter school. The city council's been involved with that. They pushed this for a couple of years. That's a good step, okay, in the direction of getting competition. And again, it's not everything you want, but you have to do things in stages. Life, you know, if we had some things happen in Washington stages, maybe we wouldn't be in the mess we're in right now. So, again, I think, and I will, Dale, I'm going to get you. And if there's a better way to do property taxes, that's fine. But I don't see it happening anytime soon. Sometimes you got to work within the system. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was going to ask, rather than putting caps on movements, why not fix the valuation process?
Well, because part of
something screwed up there.
Well, there's a system that they use. It's a computerized system. You've got people involved. You've got 180 counties. You've got all degrees of sophistication in these counties. Probably brighter minds than me need to delve into that situation. But I do think, I mean, it can always be improved. I'm not saying that. And they are doing a better job with these systems. I tell you what I really liked in this whole process. I met the guy at DeKalb County Assessors, and he was very reasonable. He was really good to deal with. And I enjoyed that. We didn't agree on everything, but he was very good to deal with. You can imagine the assessor's office that I didn't have a lot of pleasure with in this process.
On the sanctions for not providing information requested, to me it sounds like those times might be relatively short, and I'd have some question about their ability to comply if there's a lot of appeals, which there have been.
Right.
So is the objective there to actually impose the penalties or to cause them to function so that they don't generate so many appeals?
Some would say that, you know, it's sort of like the governor's opportunity school district. If you don't clean up your act, we're coming. Okay? And I guess maybe from that standpoint, it's more of a put them on notice, I think.
Well, are these sanctions? I haven't read it. I wish I had.
I don't have the dollar. You know, I'm not there. I think it may be 1,000. I can't. If it's 1,000. I figure maybe 1,000. Because somebody said, why we should make it 10,000? I said, well, you can only get so many years. I can't remember what the penalties were actually.
Is that something the taxpayer would instigate if they didn't get the?
Yes.
So who gets paid the penalty? Taxpayer.
No, taxpayer gets it. It goes into my per diem. No. But again, I think this stuff's important, okay? And again, I do think it'll be a better process for people. A lot of it's awareness too. People don't know. You know, they go down there, they get these letters in the mail, you know, and particularly. The worst part about this is when you have values like the gentleman that sent me the letter who's on a fixed income. I mean, I want you to remember, for most people, if they don't have a mortgage anymore, this is their highest obligation other than maybe what they give to their church. Okay? This is their biggest obligation that they face is their property taxes. Okay? In many cases. And we've got people that are exempt for certain reasons because of certain income thresholds. But this is a significant dollar amount. And when you increase it 60% in 1 year, nobody budgeted for that. Okay, we're asking people to be personally responsible. I can be personally responsible. Get the bill in August. Okay, well, that's not fair. I guess you get it earlier notice because you get the assessment. You can't believe it. You're in a state of catatonic shock.
Well, that's from April.
Yeah, that's from April. From April, you got to come up with the money here by September 30th for half the money, and by November, the rest of it. Yes, Jeff.
I don't know if this will affect, but the county's proposed having to go around and take a picture of every property house in the county so they would have an evaluation of that property. I
think that's doable right now with Google and everything else. I mean, you can zoom in on any house you want to zoom in on.
Well, apparently they're going to go around and take a picture of every house in the county and
based upon DeKalb County's priorities today, I don't know how far down that is in the list, but somehow that tells me that's probably not at the top of the spectrum. We continue to make the news, obviously, in DeKalb County. I'm not going to comment on the C.J. Becker thing, except to say this. During her course of being a judge, things that I saw over the years, I found her to be a very, very good judge. I've read some conflicting articles on what exactly is going on in the situation with C.J. Becker. And I'm not sure if what we're necessarily reading in the paper is all the facts at this point in time. I guess we'll find that out in the course of the trial. But again, one of the things about our system, even though we paint people with a brush, they are innocent until proven guilty. And I do know one thing, that grand jury indictments, okay, that is strictly a one-sided process. I do know that as well. So I think we'll see what happens in that particular thing. And I'm very sad about that. And I guess because John Boyer got sentenced this past week for a year and a day or whatever in Club Fed. And then the other gentleman that was involved, the bag man,
Brooks,
him too. So. Stan Watson, who I've known for a long, long time, got a slap on the wrist from the Ethics Commission. I didn't quite understand that, you know, even though I consider him a friend over the years. What he did was wrong in several instances, and to me that did not set a very good precedent. And the good news is we're replacing the Ethics Commission later on this year, based on legislation we passed, that they will not be appointees by the county commissioners going forward. It'll be from various groups that set up in the law how it is. Seven or eight groups have decided who the ethics members will be. The current board chairman resigned this past week because he's going to run as a Democrat for the mayor's position in Brookhaven. One thing about DeKalb, it's making the state look pretty good lately. I've heard, we don't have any scandals that I can think of that come to mind at all. And the political thing continues with the president, presidential race. I think whether you like him or not, you have to admire the inroads that Ted Cruz has made. I thought I was going to say Donald Trump, didn't I? You have to admire the inroads Ted Cruz has made. Very interesting to me. Watch. He's really counting on the Southern primary, it looks like, because I think he has to be quite honest with you, to get any traction. It's got to happen for him in the South. Just like the gentleman I happen to like, I like Kasich, it has to happen to him in New Hampshire. Rand Paul, it has to happen for him that he gets invited back to the next debate, based upon what Governor Christie did to him. That could be very interesting to see what happens there. So Hillary continues to plummet in the polls, but we don't even know if that even matters at this point in time. I saw what Joe Biden has 53% trust, and she's got 32%. Maybe it's good to be a socialist. Bernie Sanders is looking better every day to a lot of people. I don't know. You know, I know you live free and die up in New Hampshire. My cousins are from there. But I'd be real concerned if I knew Bernie Sanders was leading the primary in my particular state, but nevertheless. Yes, Kathy.
Well, I think the reason that people like Bernie Sanders, as terrifying as he is, are looking good is because the Republicans are not cutting government the way we would like them to be. And this is not just national, you know, it's at the state level too. And you know, what you mentioned about property taxes, why don't y'all come up with an awesome property tax plan and everyone will work on selling it to everybody? Like, why don't we actually cut some government?
You know, I would say, Captain, that's a noble purpose, okay? But I will tell you, to try to change something that's been around for a very long time is very difficult. And if you can make it better while you're doing it. You know, we've tried to do some things, as you know, with consumption tax down in the legislature every year. In fact, there's now another bill right now, John Carson, I believe, is a representative, brought forth a tax. You're familiar with it. And I think we may go in that direction based upon what happens in the House in that particular bill. But, you know, anytime you deal with tax policy, people say, well, you know, right now there's, you know, cut the income tax, do this, do that. You've got to look at the total implications of what it means, too. I mean, you've got to fill a revenue hole after you do this one and that one. It's not that easy. It's one of the reasons why in a budget, when we vote on a budget, this is very, very important. I'm going to close with this. We vote in a budget, $22 billion, right? When it comes to the floor, people like me vote on it. There aren't amendments to the budget, folks. They don't cut now. That doesn't happen on the floor. Whether you like that or not, that's not reality. It happens in the appropriations process when they do that. And I don't sit in those committees. And that's what I'm going to close with. Because, you know, I keep reading about how I support refugee Islamic terrorists and so on and so forth. And the state budget, I got about this much information, I think we actually want to see it. We have a $9.3 million item in our state budget for refugee resettlement. The refugee, out of the $22 billion budget, it is strictly 100% federal funds, including the people that administer the program are paid by federal money, including their fringe benefits. There's not one dime of state money that goes into this particular program. And yes, I guess I do support it if I vote yes on the budget, because I took the $9 million versus coming back to you and asking you for the $9 million. So, you know, when we start to criticize for things, and that's fine, because we all can be criticized. Bob's the only one in this room that's perfect, since he took Senator Tysinger's place. We can all be criticized, okay? But let's get our facts.
Thank you. Thank you, Fran. Anyway, she saw significant change in England, a country at the time that was faced a lot of challenges. Yes.
Wow. You think there's any chance we could get Mike Bowers or his investigator Hyde to come talk to us a little bit?
Well, I guess if they get paid or not, we might decide that question.
Well, we'll contribute $500.
Well, we could.
Hey, how big a checkbook you got?
Hey, you know, that's not a bad idea. I call Mike.
I mean, they have talked already some in the paper.
No, that's an interesting set of circumstances, and certainly his perspective on that might be of interest to us here. So I'll reach out to him. We still have Robert James on deck, and I think we'll have more of the judges come here. And realize that's one of the things that we like in terms of being in DeKalb County and this organization, is reaching out to all of our policymakers, because they all influence our day-to-day lives, quite frankly, more than anything nationally. Yes, John.
Speaking of that, when does that report due?
Well, it depends on who you talk to, I guess. County wants it, at the end of this month? And
26th.
Yeah, and then according to him, he said, October?
October 3rd, I think.
Yeah, so there's a disconnect as to which is correct. Unless anybody here knows, I only know what's in the paper.
Well, that's soon.
Well, I think it's soon. I mean, October to me is just around the corner. I look at my caseload and I think, oh my gosh, I got work to do. So anyway, well, thank you all for being here. It's been a great meeting, and I will see you next week. Thank you.